Hi everyone, Aaron here for Zolotech, and today Apple released iOS 16.2 RC. This is the release candidate, or the final version that will release to the public if there's no additional issues, and they first released iOS 16.2 release candidate to developers and public beta testers. Now this will be supported on the iPhone 8, 8 Plus, all the way up to the iPhone 14 Pro and Pro Max. And this came in at a very large 5.33 gigabytes on the 14 Pro Max, and was about 5 gigabytes on all the devices here. That's because anytime you go from a beta version to a public version, it's going to be a full install. It will overwrite the other storage and then install the whole operating system. And along with this, Apple also released iPadOS 16.2 RC, macOS 13.1 RC, watchOS 9.2 RC, tvOS 16.2 RC, and HomePod OS 16.2 RC, along with older supported versions for 15.7.2 RC of both iOS and iPadOS. Now, if you're wondering if you're a beta tester and if you should remove the beta profile, at this time, I would probably keep it just in case they release an RC2 or release candidate 2 with iOS 16.2 RC2. They've done that in the past. If they don't, well, then you can just delete the beta profile when it comes out to the public. And we'll talk about when to expect that a little bit later. Now let's go ahead and take a look at the build number and talk about what's new. So we'll go to settings, then we'll go to general, then about. And if we tap on the iOS version, you can see the final build, as long as this is the final build and no additional bugs are found, is 20C65. And this particular update has a lot of different changes and features in it. And the first thing is, Apple announced today that they're abandoning CSAM detection. That's according to a statement made by Apple to Wired, where they would scan your photos and then send that information off. They've completely abandoned that process, and they've brought some new features instead. Now, the first thing is they've brought Apple Music Sing. Apple Music Sing is a way to use your phone for karaoke. And I found this works with just about everything as long as you have a supported device. And those supported devices are iPhone 11 all the way up to the iPhone 14 Pro Max. And it also includes the iPhone SE third generation. It needs the neural processor apparently to do some of these features. And so what you do is you just go into your music app, go into maybe a song, and you'll see this little microphone icon here. We'll just turn it down here. And if you tap on the microphone, you can turn the lyric volume up and down. So it actually completely removes the lyric part of the track and you can't hear it. And then when you go ahead and sing along to it, you'll see as he's singing, it actually goes along with this particular track. Depending on how he's singing, it will change and sort of follow along. Now, I've found that on specific tracks, it doesn't have all of the features. So if we go to maybe something that's maybe a little more mainstream. So for example, the song Even Flow by Pearl Jam, if maybe we go to this part of the lyrics here, you'll see that it actually follows along in the flow that he's actually singing the song. So you can see that here, and then you can adjust the volume of the singer up and down for the lyrics. So this works really well. You can turn it up and down, and it works surprisingly well. Like I said, it doesn't follow along for every single song that I've found, but it seems to work really well on pretty mainstream songs, and there will be more to this in the future with newly enhanced beat by beat lyrics, as you can see here, as well as duet with the original artist, a solo, a sing solo, or mix it up. And that is available on this update. So anyone that installs this update when it's available to the public will have it on the supported devices. The next thing that's new is the Freeform app. This I've talked about in previous beta updates, and this allows for collaboration across multiple devices with multiple people on Mac, iPad, and iPhone. So as you can see in the Freeform app, they promised this with iOS 16, and we've now seen it with 16.2. If we go into the app, you'll see here there's a new splash screen, and let's go to a board that's synced across iCloud, and you can see the new Freeform app here, and maybe I want to draw on it. So we'll just draw a little squiggly line. You can see in real time, it's actually updating, and with the RC, it's even faster than before. So that gives you an idea of how fast it is. It draws the line almost at the same time I'm moving my finger across the screen. It's incredibly fast and a great way to collaborate. So you can use that. They call it a flexible canvas that lets you add files, images, stickies, and more. Now, if we go into settings and then we go to our name at the top and then tap on iCloud, scroll to the bottom, and there's an all new advanced data protection option. And if we go into this, you'll see it says iCloud encrypts your data to keep it secure. Advanced data protection uses end-to-end encryption to ensure that iCloud data types listed here can only be decrypted on your trusted devices, protecting your information even in the case of a data breach in the cloud. It also says, because Apple will not have the keys required to recover your data, you will be guided through verification of your recovery methods in case you ever lose access to your account. And you'll see what it can encrypt here. So your device backup, messages, iCloud Drive, notes, photos, reminders, Safari bookmarks, Siri shortcuts, voice memos, and wallet passes. And then you can set up your account recovery. So if you go ahead and turn it on, it will actually walk you through a guided process and says you will be responsible for your data recovery. So we can set that up, and then you can add a recovery key, add a recovery contact, and go through that process. A recovery key is a 28 character code that you keep in a safe place. You can use it to recover your data if you lose access to your account. So if you want to set this up, you can. And they also announced today that coming later in 2023, they're going to have advanced user security with powerful new data protections, with iMessage contact key verification, security keys for Apple ID, and advanced data protection for iCloud. And if you scroll down on their press release, you can see here, it will even verify the contact you're speaking to let you know that it's the actual person you think it is. So if you're talking to someone that you are not sure who they are, it will let you know. And then you'll have security keys. We've had this on Android for a bit where you can use your device as a security key and sign in with that as well. And you'll be able to actually use the port as a security key and verify it's you. So a lot of great data encryption protections coming to iOS. And it's something that I think addresses a lot of the privacy concerns we've seen for quite some time with this update. Now, this update should also bring 5G support to India. They didn't specifically mention it, but we know that it was in the betas, so it should be here as well, where you'll have the option to switch between 5G on, auto, and LTE. So that's something we should see as well. There's also some new settings for your lock screen. So first let's talk about new widgets, and then we'll take a look at the new settings. So if we go into our lock screen and we go to customize, then maybe we'll customize the lock screen, and let's take a look at some of our widgets. And if we scroll down, you'll see that we have an all new sleep widget. So there's a sleep widget here. You can have a small one or a larger one showing how long you were in bed and when you woke up throughout the night, just giving you a quick glanceable update on your information. And then there's also an update for medications as well. So if we go to health, you'll see that we have medications. So if you have some medications scheduled, it will let you know through a widget on your lock screen as well, or within the notification center. Now, if we go into our settings and then scroll down to display and brightness, scroll down again, you'll see always on display. We've been able to turn this off and on before, but now we can show the wallpaper or turn the wallpaper off. The same is true with notifications. So if I lock the phone, you'll see there's no wallpaper. It's just completely dark. You can enable that if you'd like, and then lock it again, and you'll see the wallpapers in the background. So if that's something you want to turn off, you can now turn it off. It should probably save a little bit of power, but I've seen very minimal change as far as that goes when it comes to the overall power consumption with the show wallpaper option on or off. Game Center finally adds SharePlay support. We've had SharePlay for a while, but not for games. So if there's a multiplayer game you're playing, you can now play with people you're on a FaceTime call with. There's also a new widget to help you out with that. So if we go to our widgets, go to edit, add a new one. Under Game Center, if we scroll over, you'll see a new activity widget that lets you know what your friends are doing. So there's a couple different versions here, but if we pick this one, we'll add this one, and we can see in real time what they've played or are playing and how they've done. So this is a way to maybe help collaborate and play a multiplayer game together. Back in settings, if we scroll down, we'll go down to the TV app. TV finally gains live activities. This is something that we've wanted for a while, where we can now have more frequent updates. And also, not only that, we can now follow different live sporting events so that we can have them on our display. If we go into the TV app, give it a moment to load here, you'll see that it comes up with a new splash screen and says one sports experience, more from TV Plus. We'll hit continue and then scroll down. We'll go down until we get to live sports. And under live sports, if there's a game that's currently live, you can then follow along. So if I want to follow this one, it's telling me when it is, but if it was live, I could follow it and then see live activities to go along with that. So during the World Cup, there were a ton of those, and I know a lot of people really appreciated that, so they could see their live sports in real time. And you can see it says follow your teams, get notified about your team so you never miss the action. Messages gets an update as well, and this is pretty subtle and something we didn't know with the betas. And if we go into messages, and if we go to search for something, there's improved search in Messages that allows you to find photos based on their content, such as a dog, car, or person, or text. So if there's a photo in there, we'll try car, and you can see here it's finding things with a car in it. There's a Rivian right there and different information that says car. So it's great that they've updated that. Now, Apple has also updated the Home app with improved reliability and efficiency of communication between your smart home accessories and Apple devices. There's a new feature that updates privacy for Safari. So if we go into Settings, tap on our name, and then go to iCloud again, as long as you have Private Relay enabled, you'll have a new option in Safari. If you go to Safari, tap on the AA for your settings, we have the option to hide or show your IP address. If I tap on show, you'll see it says apple.com will temporarily see your IP address. We'll hit continue and then it can see that. So that's something they've updated, and then you can change it to hide IP address. That's all new in this update and something that they've brought that should help for many different websites if you're using Private Relay. Now, if you go into the weather app, you're going to start seeing news articles in certain cities. So as I scroll down here, I don't see anything here, but in major cities, some people are seeing news articles. So here's Charlotte. And again, if there's a weather advisory or something else, you should see it here. Again, I'm not seeing it, but many people are starting to see those around the country. There's something major that they've added with iOS 16.2 RC that I would like an additional option for. If we go to our settings and go to general, then go to AirDrop, you'll see everyone now says for 10 minutes. This is something they recently added in China that after 10 minutes, it will jump back to contacts only. And while that's a nice security option, my understanding is that sometimes people want to send you something that's nearby so that you can see this, and apparently that prevents it after 10 minutes. I would like an option. Maybe if we're in a conference room and someone wants to send something, they're not on your contacts list, I would love to see it jump back to just everyone and let me control that. So give me an additional option for everyone, everyone for 10 minutes and contacts only. So that's something that's changed in this update. Originally, it was just with the previous updates with iOS 16.1.2, 16.1.1. That's something I would love to see updated here with iOS 16.2 when it finally releases to the public. Within Notes, if you're collaborating and sharing a note with someone, you'll now see the cursors here update in real time with live indicators as to someone making a change to that note. So if you're sharing the note across multiple people, you'll see when they're actually editing it. With the iPad, Stage Manager gets updated on supported devices to allow for external displays now. So there's external display support with resolutions up to 6K, so that's a Pro Display XDR, but it's only on the iPad Pro 12.9 fifth generation and later, so basically the M1 iPad or M2 iPad. And that works really seamlessly now as I've been using it throughout the betas. So if we plug it in, you can see here what it looks like, where you actually have full external display support with the full monitor showing as though it was just a Mac. So that's something that's really great. You can also drag and drop files and windows from your compatible device to your connected display and vice versa. And it supports up to 4 apps at once on the iPad display and 4 on the external display. And as far as bug fixes, well, they've fixed a few things. They've fixed an issue on the iPad where it could cause multi-touch gestures to become unresponsive when using the Zoom accessibility feature. So that should be resolved on iPad. They didn't mention it for the iPhone though. Also, they've fixed an issue that caused some notes not to sync with iCloud after updates were made. A lot of people were complaining about notes not syncing properly. That should be fixed in this update. Additionally, on the iPhone 14 and 14 Pro models, they've optimized crash detection again. They did this with iOS 16.1.2 and again with this update. And so maybe that has to do with people that were on ski slopes accidentally triggering it. Prior to that, we heard about people on roller coasters in theme parks triggering it. So that's something that you want to be able to use if you're in trouble and need to use it, but also if you're on a roller coaster, you may need to turn off as it was causing errors with that. So hopefully they've optimized that and it can detect the difference now, but we'll have to wait and see. Now, additionally, they don't mention anything else that they've fixed. So whether or not they've actually issued updates that fix the swipe home bug, that's something that takes a couple days to actually see usually. So if you play swipe home, it goes up into the dynamic island. That's something we typically see with errors. There's also small enhancements here and there to the dynamic island, visual changes and more that I'll cover in the full iOS 16.2 update. As far as additional bugs and issues, well, the storage bug some people are saying is taking up excessive storage. I'm not really seeing that anymore. It's typically what you would think, and it's going to use cache data as it can if you have that storage available. But in general, storage should be quite good, and it is taking a bit to load, but I'll give it just a moment. And you'll see it's done calculating as I scroll down. iOS is taking up 9.59 gigabytes. That's pretty typical. And this can actually shrink a little bit as it continues to optimize the OS after a new install. And system data is 37.87 gigabytes. This is cache data that can kind of shrink on its own as needed. So I really wouldn't worry about it too much. It's really at the bottom, so you don't need to look at it. And if it's actually taking up room where you can't install apps, then it's a problem. But I really haven't heard of that too often anymore. As far as the overall performance, it seems nice and fast. ProMotion is super smooth. Everything seems to be smooth, as well as the animation so far. Like I mentioned, playing a song, it going into the dynamic island. It seems nice and fast, but it will take a few days to know if it changes at all. And the same is true with battery life. Battery life can vary greatly. After you install a major update, it's going to take a while to index, process other files in the background, and optimize the whole OS. And once it's done doing that, then battery should improve. That can take a day or two depending on what you're doing with the device. So overall, it should be pretty good, but battery health on this device is 100%. And if we take a look at the last 10 days, battery life hasn't been great, but it is a beta. And as you can see here, yesterday I used about 50% of my battery and only had 2 hours and 18 minutes of screen active time, 3 hours and 58 minutes of screen idle time. Depending on the day, it varies greatly, but I think this should be a good improvement, as so far today we're seeing 2 hours and 40 minutes of screen active time and 54 minutes of screen idle time. Now, as far as if you should install iOS 16.2 RC, well, I would recommend it if you're on any of the iOS 16.2 betas, and this should be the final version. So if you were wanting to try it, you were a little bit nervous, you definitely could do that. But if you have a computer, that would be great. That way you can downgrade if you have a problem. Just make sure you have a backup before you try it. Apple typically doesn't recommend installing a beta on your main device. However, a release candidate is kind of in between a beta and the final version. This very likely could be the final version released to the public. If not, like I said, there will be another one. Now, as far as when to expect the final version released to the public, well, I would expect that probably Monday at this point. That's what we saw last year. It typically is on a Monday. It could be on Tuesday the 13th. Either one of those days is when I would expect it. And then we'll move on maybe later in the week to iOS 16.3 beta 1. We won't see another update typically until sometime in January with that. Also, I would expect iOS 15.7.2 to release to the public, probably around the same sort of date of the 12th. So both of those I would expect around that time, along with the iPad and macOS updates and more. Now, I did run benchmarks quickly, as many of you have asked for that. And even though the device was processing and getting a little bit warm, it is still a little bit warm after using it. And let me share that with you quickly with the FLIR thermal camera. You can see here with the thermal camera, it's at about 28.4 is the highest I've seen as far as Celsius. Let's go over to Fahrenheit. And as you can see at the warmest point, it looks to be about 85.2 degrees or so. So for the most part, it's staying fairly cool, even though it is a little bit warm and computing in the background. That's not super hot, and I think it's doing really well. And as far as the overall Geekbench scores, I ran this right after installing it, so it is a bit warm, and I would expect these to go up a little bit. But we had 1,886 for single core, 5,379 for multi-core. That's quite good compared to what we had before, as the single core is a little bit higher, multi-core is a little bit lower, but again, it's processing a lot in the background, so I would expect this to improve. And we'll talk more about that in the follow-up on the weekend to make sure that it's good to go to install on your main device. If you've found anything else or would like me to mention anything else in these videos, I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. And of course, if you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, it will be linked in the description as it always is. If you haven't subscribed already though, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.